Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. So I am sitting between you and your lunch, so I'm going to be relatively quick. What I want to give today is really an overview of what does it mean air quality modeling, what we understand by this task. And tomorrow, I will have a little more time to show you some example of how we use the model, what kind of application we make. So today is more like the overview to really have a better understanding of what is in this strange beast that we call air quality model. My name is Augustin Colette, and I wanted also to take the opportunity of thanking the organizer to inviting me here. And I'm from the French National Institute working on industrial environment and risks, which is a body which stands between research and support to policy at mainly the national level and European and international level. So, what are air quality models? I can maybe just type. So, air quality models are used to make nice movies like this one, where you can see the transport of fine PM, PM2.5, over the globe, over the northern hemisphere. And when you look at that, besides the somewhat hypnotic view, you realize that air pollution is far from being a very localized issue. There is a problem, which is the long-range transport of air pollution. And to represent that, we actually use numerical models that will produce the plumes and advect them over long distances. So my expectation today is to try to explain you how these tools work, and so that you don't have the feeling that those are some kind of black boxes. Just to work on the risk assessment that we do, we split when we do the work between accidental risk and chronic risk. Here we are talking about chronic risk, where we actually need to understand what is the toxicity and the exposure. I will talk only about exposure today. And the other type of activity we can undertake is accidental risk, where what we want to understand is what is really the hazard and the probability of that hazard. So here, I will only talk about exposure and actually only about concentration, air pollution concentration modeling. And exposure is something that is, of course, being used to feed the health impact part, if we start from the end of this diagram. So I understand that up to today, you have heard a lot about health impact assessment. And to assess this health impact, you need to have good information about exposure. Exposure is an information you derive when you know the concentration of air pollutant and the population, location, and behavior. But if you want to know the concentration of air pollutant, you need to know the emission of air pollution. And if you don't want to know the emission of air pollutant, you need to understand human activities. So all this chain of different parts of the assessment are equally important. And the one I want to focus today is really those three in the middle here that are used, that we need to address if we want to assess what is the exposure of the population to air pollution given a degree of human activity. So when you want to assess exposure, in very general, you need to make choices depending on the scales and the tools that you have at hand. The scales can be spatial scale or temporal scale. Spatial scale is whether you want to look at the exposure of an individual, or a city, or a country, a continent, or global scale. And the spatial scale, you want to know if you are looking at exposure at day-to-day variability, or more like the annual, over the whole lifetime. So those are choices that you are going to make when you start your exposure assessment. And then you have things you don't necessarily choose, what you have at hand, the tools, whether you have observations. Now you have this new type of observation that are citizen monitors, low-cost sensors, that can be used also maybe in the future to assess exposure. You have the regulatory networks and maybe satellites or other type of information. That's from observation side. And then you have everything that I put in this box of algorithm, where you would put air quality models, but also land use regression type of approaches, or data assimilation, data fusion. So all these different tools, you can have them at hand, or you decide to engage and develop them. And I will show you today what we can do for the exposure for those areas that are actually underlined on this plot. and hoping to convince you about the confidence or also the uncertainty and the precaution we should have when we mobilize these tools. Air quality modeling. Broadly speaking, there are two different type of approaches. Both have pros and cons. On the left-hand side here, you have chemistry transport modeling, which we call deterministic. We'll come back to that. And on the other side, you have more the geostatistical regression, which is more statistical type of approach. In the chemistry transport model, you will want to represent the actual behavior of the atmosphere. It's a more physical type of approach. And it's also more sensitive to changes. If you want to model what is going to happen today or 10 years from now, you want to have a model that is more sensitive and therefore more physical. The obvious drawback of those models is that they are complex to use, and they are also prone to model biases. Geostatistical regression, they are more fitted to observation. They are more calibrated. So they have, by definition, less bias. So it's clearly an advantage of those. But then, on the other hand, they're not sensitive to changes. They describe well a situation for a present day or given situation in a location when you have good data. But if you want to extrapolate, you should always be a bit cautious. So with this matrix of decision, you see that it's not necessarily obvious to say which tool you want to look. But what you want to really be, what you really need to keep in mind is the fact that for air quality, we have quite two important specificities. The first one is the nonlinear chemistry and the production of secondary species. So air quality is the result of primary emission of air pollutant, but then there are secondary species that are formed in the atmosphere, ozone and secondary PM. And this is nonlinear and complex, so this is something that must be addressed. And also, there is long-range transport of air pollution from one place to another, from the background to a city, from a country to the next country, even from a continent to, to another continent. And all these processes are better captured with models that actually reproduce the atmospheric behavior. So I'm trying to explain you today how air quality models work. I'm not saying they are perfect. On this slide, I say clearly that they are complex and sometimes you have biases. And I will come back to that in more detail. But you have to be aware also when you make the choice that there are some processes in the atmosphere that cannot be addressed if you don't have this type of complex models. So how chemistry transport model works? You have the actual model in the middle, and then you have the different input data, forcing of the model, as we call it. If you take a regional chemistry transport model, region would be a continent, like Europe, for example, then you need to force it with a global chemistry model at the boundary of Europe. You also need to know what is the regional meteorology, the variability of the winds that will drive your pollutant plumes, and emission of key species. I will spend some work explaining you what is in the model and then also trying to detail what we call the forcing data and how we can get them. What's inside the regional transport chemistry transport model? Basically, one equation, the variation in time of concentration of a given species, which we compute as an advection term, so that species being transported from elsewhere to the location we are looking at. And then we add some production and withdraw some loss terms. Production and loss is the balance between the chemistry, production of the change in the atmosphere, also emission and inflow of air pollutants from the bottom, and loss by deposition. So this is the very fundamental equation of the atmospheric chemistry transport models. If we look first at transport, And deposition then. So transport, what we call the transport of air pollution, is really the advection. So if you consider one model grid box, like this box here, we have an advective flow, just wind coming in with some pollutant inside. So that will bring you some pollutant in the area you're looking at, and also it will, of course, bring out some of it. So this is really the advective of the laminar flow that contributes to the pollution in a given area. Then there is another type of transport that is very important as well, is the mixing and all the turbulence of the atmosphere. And for that, we actually divide mixing and turbulence in chemistry transport model between two broad kinds. What's happening in the planetary boundary layer, in the lowermost part of the atmosphere, when you have every day some mixing, especially during the daytime. And you can also have some mixing with large-scale convection when you have large thunderstorms, for example, that would mix your whole column of the atmosphere from the ground to the stratosphere. So it can be reach like more than 10 kilometers of depth. So those are the two types of transport patterns that we want to capture, the large-scale advection and then the mixing. That's for the transport. Deposition, so deposition is a sink. It removes chemical pollutants from the atmosphere. It can be of two kinds, the dry deposition and the wet deposition. Dry deposition is just by interaction between the air and the surface. Your atmospheric pollutant parcel that are in the air will touch the ground and will be deposited to the ground and remain there. So it's a sink, it's gone from the atmosphere, it goes to the ground. It can have impacts then on the vegetation, can have adverse impact on the vegetation, but for us, as far as the atmospheric composition is concerned, it's a sink, it removes pollutants from the atmosphere. And then you have wet deposition. Wet deposition is basically precipitation, removing aerosol or gases, as long as they are prone to being scavenged from the atmosphere, they can be removed by the precipitation. And that can occur below the clouds, of course, when you have the precipitation that removes some of the aerosol and gases from the atmosphere, or it can occur in the cloud, including when you have fog. But then it's a bit more complex because those particles that are gone in the cloud, in the water droplet of the clouds, can also go back to the atmosphere. So there can be two-way processes to be taken into account. So that's it for the transport and the deposition. Now we move to chemistry with this kind of lovely schematics that chemistry researchers like to draw. It can reach various levels of complexity, the chemistry. So for the gas, you have two phases to be handled for air pollution, the gas phase and the aerosol. For the gas phase, typically, we have a few hundred species and a few hundred reactions. So those are the type of reactions that are plotted here. Interconnection between species and how the product of two species leads to another one. And we have the same for aerosol. Usually, we have a bit less species, less reaction, but also complex chemistry. And what makes things much more complex for aerosol is what we call the microphysics, the thermodynamics, when you need to understand how aerosol particles will evolve physically, how they will nucleate, coagulate, or condensate, depending on the condition. They can look, smaller particles can create larger particles and vice versa, and new particles can appear. So this is a very complex part of the aerosol evolution in the chemistry transport models. So this is being done for aerosol for different families, the organics, inorganics, and natural aerosol. The natural aerosol is typically volcanic ash, desert dust, sea salt. But then you have all the non-natural, anthropogenic aerosol. Inorganics, it's sulfate, nitrate, ammonia. Sulfate is largely induced by industrial emissions or shipping emissions today. It's very important. But organics is even more complex in terms of the chemistry, and largely due to road transportation, residential emission, and also cooking practices, depending on the area you're looking at. So this is making the picture quite complex, also in terms of the chemistry of gas and aerosol, and even more so if you start to handle heterogeneous chemistry, when you have interaction of the gases on the aerosol, and vice versa. So that's it for the chemistry so far, but I just wanted to also add a word to say that a large part of the chemistry that we are interested in is photochemistry, which is actually driven or activated by the solar irradiation. So some chemistry that is more active during the daytime under the effect of the solar illumination. And here, it can be also a quite complex field in representing that correctly in the models, because first order, it depends on the day of the year and the time of the day and the location on the globe. But it's largely affected by the clouds and also by pollution clouds. So for example, if you have a desert dust plume being advected aloft, how does it change your photochemistry near the ground? All these are the type of questions that we want to address in the chemistry transport model to actually accurately represent that photochemistry. Besides the broad pattern, the broad generality that I just mentioned for chemistry, we also note that there are some specific modules that we tend to develop depending on what we are looking at. And we may have different chemical modules, whether we look at the planetary boundary layer, for example, urban areas close to the ground, we may have a specific chemistry there, compared to the troposphere. Troposphere is more or less between 1 or 2 kilometers to 10 kilometers of altitude. And if you want to look at stratospheric chemistry, it's going to be, again, very different processes that you look at. So everything I said before is true, but you may actually direct your model development towards one or the other, depending on the areas you look at. And there is also a dependence whether looking at the surface you are looking at. I mentioned urban areas, but also, for example, snow. There is a very specific chemistry at the interface between snow and the atmosphere. It can matter in some areas. For forests as well, forests are actually a big emitter of precursor of pollutants, organic volatile compounds. So that triggers also a specific chemistry. You can also think of wildfires there. Forests can emit large amount of aerosols that will also trigger some specific chemistry. And then the desert that produce desert dust that also need to be handled. So the engine then now. If you want to do chemistry transport modeling, the choice of the tools is actually quite vast. There are a number of different models available on the market, so to say. Most of them are actually open source, and you can download them on the web. They even sometimes offer training and support. The list is probably not complete. In general, we're talking about maybe up to 100 lines of codes in Fortran, C++. So it's quite comprehensive codes, and it takes a while to develop. Most of the tools I'm mentioning here have been developed for at least 10 years. It's not something you would start today expecting to have results in 1 year or two. It runs on high-performance computers, generally something between 100 CPUs, but some high-performance simulations were done up to a few thousand. And there is a specificity that needs to be taken into account for chemistry transport models compared to meteorology, for example, is the huge amount of input and output data. Think of the fact that for chemistry, I mentioned that we had a few hundred species to handle in the model. In meteorology, they have 5. So the storing this data is really not the same problem as what we have for other type of applications. I just give order of magnitude of the runtime. Just depends a lot between the models and also the machines. But just to give you an idea, if you want to do an assessment over a long time period, over Europe, for example, and you say, OK, I don't need high resolution. I can do 50 kilometer resolution. Maybe you can simulate 1 year in 1 day. 24 hours, you simulate 1 full year for like low resolution. If you want to do a bit more high resolution and you want to look at a forecast for a few days, and you move to 10 kilometer resolution also for the whole of Europe, then you will need more CPUs, but you can go down to 3 hours. Just to give you order of magnitude, I'd say, of the various runtime. So now I hope you have a better understanding what is actually inside the model. Not going into every detail, but just so that you, I really want that to be clear that this model should not be a black box for you. And now what we actually need to drive those models. Meteorology, so we are taking from various sources, various operational centers that share their meteorological data with us. They provide us the field, the 3D field varying in time for the wind in two directions, the temperature, specific humidity and pressure. And from that we can derive a number of additional parameters that we need, for example the surface friction, the depth of the planetary boundary layer, and so on. And depending on the day of the temporal scale we are looking at, we will actually go to different providers of data. So if you're doing a forecast, you will actually ask to the American or European centers providing this forecast for free. Or you can run it for yourself if you have some colleagues who actually have an expertise in meteorological modeling. Or you can even use climate projections. Tomorrow I will mention a little bit what we are doing between air quality and climate interactions. But if you are interested to do that, you can go to IPCC and download the climate models and use that to drive your chemistry transport assessment. To have the information about global chemistry, it's somewhat similar. You contact the colleagues. It's more research-based. Now they have a few operational services provided the global evolution of the atmosphere. And from then, what you need to obtain is the evolution of the large scale, the very inflow, for example. I like this plot because you realize well that if you're focusing on one area of the continent, you need to know what is at the boundaries in terms of incoming air pollution from a large distance. A bit more on emissions. That's a very important part on when you are going to drive your chemistry transport model. There are two broad types of emissions, the natural and anthropogenic ones. For the natural, we will have the desert dust. Desert dust is quite complex to model because it relies on both land use, your knowledge of where the deserts are located, and typology, mineralogy of the dust, and also how the atmosphere from day to day is more likely to erode the dust and lift some parcels. And that's just an example of the variability of the erodibility, the roughness lengths that you can get from various databases, just to illustrate the fact that it's quite uncertain to actually know how this dust will be eroded from the surface. Another natural process is volcanoes. Here the problem is more that it's very sporadic, the emission. I mean, some of them are continuous, but most of them are sporadic. So it's difficult to know the location, the time, the magnitude of the flux that is emitted by the volcano. Another natural process is biogenic from forests, mentioned before, volatile organic compounds emitted by forests. You also have other ecosystems that emit particles to the atmosphere. It's pollens. Pollens are also emitted by the vegetation. And then you have wildfire, which can be very, very important in specific areas of the world. And those are very sporadic and of very wide various level of intensity. So it's quite difficult to know where they occur, but now we have satellites. It's actually the plot I'm showing here. So with the satellite, you can actually know where the fire is located. And you can actually even know what is the fire intensity, broadly. But then you need to relate that to ecosystem maps to know what is actually the type of forest that is being burned. And you need to evaluate then how much emission is going to lead in terms of black carbon, carbon monoxide, and so on. So all this is a degree, a whole field of research to actually better understand these emissions and how we need to take them into account in the chemistry transport model. Now moving to anthropogenic emissions, so what we at last arriving to pollution. So we will actually go to the reporting of the various countries that would actually tell us what is the flux of air pollution they think they emit. So here, they will actually provide databases of various compounds that are crucial for us, for each of the main activity sectors that are emitting pollution. So usually they provide that as country totals, and then we need to find a way to make it a spatial map and to, for example, use proxies based on population, traffic, large point sources to actually locate the flux of emission in the right area. So the sources that we use for that is the official, very official databases of reported fluxes, which are interesting because they are actually computed by using what they call activity data and emission factors. But activity data is, for example, the total fuel being sold in one country. We know that last year in Italy, they sold so many megatons of diesel and gasoline. So this is something, a figure that can be known quite precisely, actually. And then you know what is your car fleet, and then you know where the cars are driving and so on. And using emission factors, you will convert that into fluxes of like carbon, NOx, and so on. Problem of this is that they are official. So you may wonder what the countries are telling you. Maybe one country, just because they're not using the same methodology as the neighbor, doesn't have the same figure. Or maybe one country wants to undermine the emission understate the emission they are actually reporting. So for that, we are actually also working with inversion, so looking at satellite products and also models to actually take the observation from the space and go back to the sources, do an inversion of the flux, and there we can compare to the official emission inventory. So that's actually a new innovative field of work, very promising. And it's very good to benchmark the official data. Problem is, this type of data are not linked to activity. So at the end, you know what is the overall flux from a country, but you don't know if it's more traffic, residential, industry. You don't know exactly who is guilty for this emission. And what we want to do ultimately is to target those sectors and to reduce emissions. So it's interesting to have both and also to make use of the official databases. And also because these official databases are those that are used for long-term projections. So long-term projection is not knowing the pollution of today or in 2 years from now, but more like in 10 or 50 years. And there, the different countries are talking together to negotiate policy targets. We know also how the technology evolves, talking to the industry and the car manufacturer. We know how we expect things will evolve in the next few years. We know also, at least the colleagues tell us, how macroeconomics is evolving. And from all this, we can compute these alternative projections that are used to inform this policy dialogue. So all this is very important to keep in mind that inversion and the type of geophysical approach is useful because it gives you an objective view into the emission fluxes. But there is another pathway which is more connected to policy, which is also useful because it's where we want to play a role at the end. So now I'm finished with the overview, and now let's look a bit more at what these models tell us. So this is another view of the first movie I was showing before, when we use one of these CTM, 10 kilometer resolution over the whole globe, and the added value is that it's really an urban model from the beginning, so it's really well suited to model what's happening close to the ground. And here, from this movie, you can see, for example, for NOx, nitrogen oxides, typically the example of the air pollutant that is relatively short-lived. You see well the emission areas. If you look closely, I don't know on that screen if you can see that there are some shipping tracks, maybe not so visible. And those plumes can be evicted a few kilometers or tens of kilometers, but not much further. On the other side of the spectrum, you have ozone. Ozone is, by definition, the long-range air pollutant. It's being formed over polluted areas, but then it can be evicted for thousands of kilometers. And if you focus a bit on Northeast US, you have the production of ozone, and you see that the plume survives quite a lot. You have daily cycle in the production of ozone. I was saying before that what we are looking at, a lot of it is photochemistry. It's sensitive to the solar irradiance. And you can see that every day the sun is rising from the east and turning around, so you have this daily production. It's not like a transport pattern. This is really the production, the daily variability of the ozone production. If you go to other pollutants, so to say, desert dust, here you have a very good example of how desert dust can be transported over long distances. Here you just had outflow from North Africa that is being transported northward up to Scotland and England. There is also some large plumes from going away from Iran up to the top of Siberia. Of course, India is very exposed to the Gobi Desert. And last but not least, Sahara, with huge amount of particles being evicted aloft. They can even be transported across the whole Atlantic Ocean. So we are talking about transport of really literally thousands of kilometers. Here's another one, is a volcanic emission, actually a sulfur dioxide emitted by the Bardabunga volcano in 2014. You will see that in a matter of a few days, it goes around the globe, and it's really overkilling any emissions, anthropogenic of SO2 emission. So there are anthropogenic emissions of SO2, and you can see everywhere, but after a few days of volcanic eruption, it's really mixed and blurred. And the last one, which is perhaps the most interesting for health impact assessment issues, PM2.5, which is in between, more or less. So it's not a short-lived, huh? It can be transported not as much as ozone, but still, for example, from Asia here, you can see that you have some plumes that you should be able to see in a couple of days here, days in the movie, yeah, that will arrive here up to North Africa. Yes. Now it's only model. Only model. Yes?
That's okay. Is the same question? Which model do you use? And I think maybe Chimere or something else.
I have a vested interest here because I am developing Chimere, and this is Chimere simulations.
Okay.
It's a very good model, of course. There are a lot of very good models as well.
You use large scales, continents. Is it possible to use the same model for a local scale?
It depends a little bit of the model. This type of the Chimere model, it's used for city, for example, like the size of Paris. You can use Chimere, the larger Paris, up to Europe and France a lot. Here we use it for the first time for the globe, but it's not being used operational for the globe. Most of the regional models would be the same. You can use it from the city to the continent. Mainly, there are two models actually that can be used from the city to the whole globe, with the same physics and the same chemistry.
And we talked about the CPU. What's the capacity?
So this is not that huge. It's a 500 CPUs simulation, and it takes about 6 hours to run for one day. So if you want to do a forecast, you can, if you have 500 CPUs.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you for the presentation. Nice video, nice movies. The question is that to run such a model, for example, you would be using emission rates. And you indicated some sources of emission rates in your presentation. You mentioned satellite. Yes, I'm wondering, how does the satellite data give you emission rates? Like for all, you know, activities over the city of interest?
It doesn't. The satellite would give you the net emission. Well, the satellite will actually not give you emission. The satellite will give you the concentrations. So the satellite, man, it sees instantaneous concentrations. And even more so, it doesn't see concentration near the ground. It sees the total concentration of the atmosphere. And in very many cases, they are more sensitive in the upper layer of the atmosphere, and they are relatively blind close to the ground. But these concentration maps of the satellite, they can be inversed using models. So you take this snapshot of satellite, and with the model, you actually go backwards. You can have models that drive forward and backward. So if you drive backward with your model, you can go back to the emission flux. But then what you have to be aware is that you have a net emission flux. So maybe for a given grid box, for a given area, you know what is going out, but you don't know to what extent this is being due to industry, traffic, residential. I mean, it's a sum. So it's good to have this information, to benchmark the inventories, but you also need to have the inventories.
Okay, I am asking about SO2 and volcanic ash emissions. So how they are estimated in the model?
It's not systematic. We do that only when there is a major eruption. And when there is a major eruption like this one, there was a paper in the literature, but I don't remember who estimated this emission flux, telling you, okay, it started that day, it finished that day. The flux was so many tons a day, and it was from that altitude to that altitude, and the composition was such. So this is work that is being conducted by local experts, mainly, and they publish that when there is a major eruption. By local experts. And they do that when there is a major eruption. If you have to do that on operational basis, as soon as there is an eruption and you have to start a simulation, for example, if you are advisory to aviation, for example, like your institute is, for example, you need to have operational real-time information to drive your dispersion model. That is much more complex. So then you will go to automated data in nearby, radar, satellites, to try to estimate what is the altitude and flux in real-time. But if for the example I'm showing here, we did the simulation a couple of years after the case, so we had the information already published.
Yes, you are aware about our job. So I am asking if it exists a database which is updated operationally. No,
I do not to my knowledge.
So my question is about the ecosystem model that used for pollen calculation. What is the data or the input data used for pollen? And second question
for pollen?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Question is about the, you talked about resolution, low and high resolution. Have you an idea about the acquired configuration for workstation needed for such a model?
So for ecosystem, it's a complex field. So there is two type of ecosystem emission that we are handling: the COV emission, organic volatile organic compound emission. And that is from you have different models that produce that from a database of land use and which type of forest is located in which area, depending on that and the variability of the meteorology, you will have a model again that will tell you what is the flux of different type of VOCs. For pollen, the emission is actually even more complex because you need to have a phenology model, a phenology. Some information about the evolution of the plants over the year. So, for example, the plants will actually activate the pollen season depending on the accumulated heat for a given year, and depending on the year you're looking at, it may start earlier or later. So this is being handled by the phenological model that tells you, okay, how the plant is behaving, is it mature enough, and when it starts to be mature, it will produce pollens. But then the pollen is not necessarily lifted into the atmosphere. It's a bit the same as the dust. I don't know if you are familiar with that, but in the plants you have the pollens. They are available to go to the atmosphere, but it needs, again, specific conditions about dryness, wind, so that the pollens are actually taken out from the plant and being lifted and transported into the atmosphere. The workstation, it depends. It's too variable. You have to try, basically. But that's why I was giving this number. Now, most of the models, since in the time, they're becoming more and more complex. So now, most of the models, you actually need to have some CPUs, but at least like 10, 30 CPUs to start to really do some assessments. You can run Chimera on a Mac laptop. You can. But it's like just to do one simulation of a few days to see how it works. But if you really want to use it as a forecasting or assessment system, you need to have a bit more computing power.
Let's move on, I think, because we otherwise we'll be out of time.
15 minutes. I just wanted to say, so the model world would be wonderful if we did not have observations. So now we have observations, and what should we do with it? So three type of activity: validation, assimilation, fusion. Validation is where you confront your model to an external set of observations. Assimilation is when you put your observation inside the model. And fusion is when you correct your model with observation. So validation, basically, we take a data set. We interpolate the model in time and space. It can be different type of observation. If you have a surface, a regulatory network, you interpolate at the location of the network. We're getting ready so that one day we can use also this emerging low-cost sensor technology. But at the moment, we do not consider that they are satisfactory for validation. We can also compare the model to vertical profile when you have this balloon sounding that are launched, or aircraft, or LIDAR, teledetection from the ground. And then, obviously, the teledetection from space, so satellite. So all this can be used in when you are validating your model. You can be quite creative in terms of metrics to validate your models. So the most basic is to look at a bias, and then a correlation, and then a root mean square, and then the list is long. But there are various ways to compare your model with observation, and there are various ways to show it. And here I'm showing various different type of plots that are being used in the community when we do this type of evaluation. Maybe I just wanted to make you sensible to the first two, the scatter plot, the one we know the most and the one which is the most dangerous. Scatter plot is basically you have observation, you put it generally on the x-axis, and models, you put it on the y-axis, and you look a bit at your cloud of points. And then some people invented the log-log scatter plots, which is very convenient because even if you have a big ball of points, then on the log-log it will go very close to the one line. So you have to be aware that when you look at this type of plots, you still have to be critical in your reading of the plots. It's also quite different when you look at a scatter plot in time or in space. In time, you are looking at the variability at one station. Okay. In space, you might be comparing two sites that have nothing to do together. So very polluted site and a very pristine site. So you expect that your scatter plot is decent, at least. So all this needs to be read with a little bit of cautious and also handled. And then you have this more complex hybrid plots when you actually display your scores in multi-directional dimensions. So you can put the mean bias versus the root mean square error. Here you will have what we call the soccer plot with your criteria that you define. And those models or those stations where the model perform well is within the area. One plot which is frequently used is the Taylor diagram. It looks a bit complex, but when you have some practice, it's actually very convenient because you would display on the same plot the variability of the model, the centralized root mean square error, and the correlation. Don't have time to go into detail, but you need to know that it exists. And depending on the way you look at the model, you have all the information on the same plot. And one that is now being developed also is the target plot, when you have various criteria, and also you can select those models or those stations where the model behave well or not. Model validation can also be done against satellites. And here I'm showing AOD, for one model simulation, and then the corresponding satellite for the given day. So you have some information from the satellite, but you always have this problem with satellites that they are affected by clouds. And where you have clouds, you don't have the information anymore. So what you do is you aggregate the satellite over a long time, longer time period. You don't look at just one snapshot, but you average over 1 month or 1 year, so that you can minimize this interference of the clouds. But then it's also different with regards to the evaluation you can do. But satellites have now a very interesting prospect. I just wanted to show this one from the very recent Sentinel-5 precursor launched late 2017, when we have very fine resolution now of NO2 from space. And the instrument will be called operational in the coming months, and we are even now expecting to have a geostationary satellite. So this is a very developing field for our work. That was it for data for model validation. Model assimilation. I don't know how many of you never heard of this concept. The idea is to feed the model online with the observation. So while you run the model, in real time, when you have observation, you put them in the model. There are various ways to do that. Ensemble approaches, for example, Kalman filter, or variational approaches, 3D VAR, 4D VAR. I encourage you to have a look if you are interested. The complexity of the variational is that you need to have a derivation of the model. You know, you need to be able to run your model in forward and backward. So basically, you need to have this derivative of the model. I told you that the model is 50,000 lines of code, so it's not obvious to do the derivation of the model. For the ensemble, basically, you need to have a big computing center. Sometimes it's more simple than derivating a model. But with this data estimation, it's a very elegant way to actually constrain the model with observation and to have the result that is really a full hybrid of both. And then the last one is data fusion. And here what you do is you correct your model offline, a posteriori. So you first do your model simulation, then you collect some observations, and you combine them after the fact, after having run your model. So here, it's mainly geostatistical type of approaches, which can be a combination of, so you use the model, you can take into account your in-situ network, you can take into account satellite, for example. And that's what is being used for this satellite map of PM2.5, that are being communicated quite a lot, especially for WHO. Actually, when you were doing the case study before with Andrea, you were using those data. when all the input information that you can get from the BreastLife portal, for example, is derived with this type of approaches, when they do a fusion of the model, the satellite, and the in-situ observations. And the last time of fusion is what we do for forecast, when we actually have a fusion of the model and not the observations, but the modeled observation. Sorry if I'm confusing you. But you, when you do a forecast, you have the situation of the present day, day plus zero, and you want to go for the day plus one, okay? You can go to the day plus one either with the chemistry transport model, you do a raw forecast of the chemistry transport model, or you can go to the day plus one by doing a statistical model at the station. So you just do statistics, correlation analysis, and you can produce a forecast at the station. Then you have these two products, a map and forecast at the station. And you can make a hybrid with data fusion type of technique, geostatistics, to have a corrected forecast for the day plus one. Now I have a couple of use cases, but I can present them tomorrow. That would be fine if you want to keep some time for the conclusion. So in that case, I jump to my conclusion.
Are you sure you have enough time tomorrow? So
yes.
Okay, so then yes, no problem. You can have some question now.
I just wanted to really to highlight the key messages before to make sure that those are well taken. I hope that with this presentation you have a better view now into what is actually in the science of chemistry transport models. I mean, you of course you have heard about those models before, but I'm not sure. I really would hate that you have the impression that those models are black boxes. You need to know a little bit what type of processes are being implemented in these models. Now you will understand they are complex. I mean, I don't want to discourage you from using it. On the contrary, they are also fascinating in a way. But we have to be cautious and always be critical about uncertainties, to be aware that they are prone to biases. So we need to validate the models. We need to do, if depending on the application, some fusion with the data, some assimilation of the data. But I want really to emphasize that question also. Why would you use such models? In the beginning, I was in my table. I had also another category, more statistical models, that have less problems. They have less physics and less problems. And they are also very good if you want to assess exposure. If you want to know what is the air quality exposure in a given place for a given day, you can go to the statistics. It will give you a very good answer. And the answer of why we are using that is that we want to do integrated assessment and we want to have some sensitivity of the model. Sensitivity is really the key word. And the reason for that sensitivity, which may sound a bit cryptic maybe, is that when I look at this chain of impact, I'm actually wondering what is the most important of these boxes. Do you have any idea? I'm asking to you. For you, in the whole integrated assessment part, what is the most important?
Everything, I think, yes.
Everything needs to be good.
Everything is too expensive.
I think everything is good, but the most important part is the human activity.
Yes, clearly. Because if there were no human activity, there would not be the other ones. It's the starting point. And we tend to forget that in what we do. Because I'm doing air quality modeling, I'm focusing on that model part, translating emission to concentration. You heard a lot about health impacts before. You heard a lot about how to move from exposure to health impacts. And people will tend to come to you, if you're a health impact practitioner, and I don't blame you, but you will come and say, okay, the most important is the health of the people, isn't it? Yes, it's the most important is the health. But if we want to do the whole thing, it's because of that. That is the starting point. And why do I say that? Is because of my position, I work at the interface between research and policy, and the policy is there. And the whole point of doing this is because we want to have an influence on policy. We want to demonstrate that air pollution has an impact because we want that impact to be reduced. The end of the story is not to have made the demonstration of the impact. The end of the story is when you manage to have a way to act toward mitigation. And that's why tomorrow I will have more examples on how we can use models to demonstrate and guide the decision-making to make the best informed decision in having a right influence on human activity to improve the air for a little bit. Thank you, I'm finished, but if you have more questions for discussion.
Maybe you can say a word on where people can get Chimère.
Go on the web. There is the, so this type of tools, I was saying, they're open source. They've been developed in research groups for 10, 20 years. One of those research groups is the French CNRS, Laboratoire de Météorologie Dynamique. And on their webpage, you can download the code. There is a very basic registration. You leave your email. And you can actually play with that code. It's open source. Modify if you want to. They also provide support with a mailing list. And most important, they also provide training every year or twice a year. There is a training session.
Thank you. I have just a comment about data fusion. So you said before that data fusion is made offline, but data fusion can also be made online. Is the same techniques as data assimilation, where the background is considered as an independent satellite data, and we assimilate another. We have a paper of the techniques in 2015. So yeah, I can give you the reference.
So I have three questions. Okay. One was about the data input, the chemical transport models and the geostatistical models, the differences. I don't know if I mistake, but is it true that the problem with the geostatistical model is the fitting? You need a lot of data to fit the statistical model.
Sorry,
now, I was to understand if it's true that for the geostatistical model, you need a lot of data, a lot of, for example, data about emissions and data about concentration, observation, to get a good model, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And compared to the chemical transport model that is more complex, but about the data that you need, it's easier to get a lot of data for the statistical model or for the chemical transport model.
The data that you have in mind, is it observation data, like
yes.
local monitoring of PM2.5? Yes? Okay. So if you're talking about that, the chemistry transport model doesn't need any. So yes, it's true that the geostatistics need more. Because okay. if you want to derive a statistical model, you need to do this correlation analysis. So you need some data. You train your statistical model in one location, and then you extrapolate. And depending on how well you've been doing your training, which proxies you've been using, and so on, your extrapolation will be good or bad. So this is really the key focus when you do your calibration of the geostatistical model. But it's essential to have data, otherwise you cannot start with. With the chemistry transport model, there is no data at all, except in the second part of my talk, when I was saying validation of the model, for example. But in the validation, you have an external data set it's really not being used in the model itself.
And about the validation, what could be considered an unacceptable correlation between a correlation index for the validation of a model, a chemical transport model? I mean, if you get a set of validation data,
yeah,
and you want to validate the model,
yes,
you get, for example, you can use a correlation.
Yes, yes.
Okay, and I wanted to know which is a good correlation value.
Oh, I think so the correlation is here, I think.
Yes.
Depends on your level of expectation. Today, if you're modeling ozone, for example, correlation is 0.8 is good, 0.7 is okay. If you're looking at PM, 0.5 is okay. Some compounds are a bit more difficult to model. So we know that at the present, the model don't have the same level of performances depending on the compounds.
Okay. And I had another question, but it's just a curiosity. When you work with this kind of regional model and a smaller scale, like you said, like Shumeric, you can use it also for an area like Paris, right? What can be the influence of the boundary condition in the case of you work in a urban scale?
Yeah, of course, the smaller you go, the larger the impact of the boundary condition. It's also quite variable depending on the compounds you're looking at. I was saying for ozone, for example, ozone has a long lifetime, so it's more important to have the good ozone at the boundaries. Other species that have a shorter lifetime, they're not so important. But indeed, if you are looking at urban air quality, in general, you need to have like a buffer domain, a bit larger, to make sure you have consistent boundary conditions. So the way it works in France, for example, we don't run a model at my institute for Paris, but we run it for Europe and France, and every day we forward the boundary condition to the local institute who is running it for Paris. But we use the same model, same setup, so we have minimum differences.
Thank you.
For me, and just an advice. For example, for a beginner, someone who would like to start in this field, what is the most important steps that can I start with? You have showed many models, CIMAC, a lot of. So which one can I choose?
Choose CIMAC, impossible. No, what else? You can go and select one you want. Most of them, they will come with a tutorial. So when you download the code, you have one case study for one air pollution episode, and you can start very easily in a few steps to start running it. So that answers your first question, how to start. You go to the tutorial, and then you are accompanied. All the models I put on the list are not open source. So you will look on the terms of conditions of the various ones. But those that are open source, they would provide support and guidance, at least for test cases.
To come back on the matter of which is the best model or which kind of performance we can accept, I think there has been some trials to define quality criteria based on bias or correlation or whatever.
Yeah, it's a big topic for us. Before that, even we did benchmarking, and that is a very important part of the work, is to do this intercomparison exercise where we put all the models together and organize a beauty contest, basically. So it's quite difficult to do, but it's quite, you learn a lot when you do that. But the nice thing is that now the community participates very actively to that. And I really acknowledge the fact that all those, I don't have the list anymore, but all these models that I mentioned, most of them, vast majority, participated to intercomparison exercise in very transparent manner, even though they know that there is a risk. When you participate, if you don't look good, you don't look good. If you look back the papers published 10 years ago, the intercomparison, they had anonymous models, model A, B, C. Yeah, but now it's not the case anymore. It's good. It's transparency. People are gaining confidence. They participate to this exercise. And if they don't look good, they accept the rule and they improve for the next time. So this is an important step in benchmarking. And then you have defining quality objectives. So this is what is being done here for the target plot. Here the target plot is, I don't read anymore, but yeah, centralized root mean square error and bias. And you would define this magic green circle, which is very sensitive. And I can tell you there are huge discussions to decide on where you should put that one. Because those models that are going to fall outside will suffer for a little while. So there are actually some normalization process being done now in Europe, where all the models are trying to agree on this type of indexes and objectives. But it's clearly something that needs a bit more than negotiation before we can come up to an agreement.
Yes, just to add a comment, people interested in comparison can go to FAIR mode and download the comparison between the models. There are a lot of papers published, so who is interested, just use FAIR mode and download it and read it. Then you can choose maybe the one you like more.
Coming back to the question, which model you have to choose, it's not only a question of performances, but it's also a question of what do you want to do.
Yes.
So if you want to study the ozone hole or the stratospheric transport or what else, so you didn't choose Chimere, but if you want, so it depends also what do you want to do.
I want to ask about the accuracy of the model compared to I speak on the Shima. Comparing the Shima with the RGCM and Dwarf. I tested it on Dwarf and between Dwarf and RGCM, and the Dwarf gave better accuracy, especially on chemistry. But comparing the Shima.
I'm sorry, I forgot to add in my list RexCM, who is actually the local model. Sorry. The answer before from Lazis was right. It depends also what you are going to do. If you want to look at pollen or organics or ozone, you will not necessarily make the same choice. And at present, I don't think you can say that one model is more accurate than the other one, because it depends also of the effort that the developers have put. So if you have one model where there is a big team working on organic chemistry, of course the model is going to be better in that, and maybe they are not so good in ozone. So it also changes in that way. But maybe the most important part of my answer to you is the model is one thing, the modeler is another thing. I am actually coordinating an intercomparison exercise when one of those models that you said were quite precise, it's clearly the worst. But I know that there was a problem with the person who has implemented it. So that's actually why we have this discussion for the evaluation of the models. We don't want to evaluate the model, but we want to evaluate the modeling, with also taking into account who is doing what. Because I don't want to have one day one of these plots with Chimere being in a very bad position because the person who has contributed was not trained. So I said before, it's complex to do, so it's a good thing to try, but it also needs a bit of caution.
Okay.
It's going just to be the last question, because the restaurant is closing at 2:00, so if you want to eat something, we really got to go. Sorry for that.
I will just do it quick. You present so many models, and you said it was sometimes very complex to use them. Which one is less complex and can be easily used on a computer like this?
Yeah.
That's the first question. The second one is, you presented a box model at the starting of the presentation. You presented something like a box model.
Yes.
at the beginning of the presentation?
Yes.
Like a box, something there, yeah. And I was wondering, I wanted to ask, in this kind of consideration, do you consider atmospheric circulation?
So, just to answer on this box model, this is not a box, what we call a box model. It's actually just one grid cell from a CTM, from a chemistry transport model. In the chemistry transport, you divide the space in grid boxes, and we're just taking one of them. So the general circulation is actually handled with that grid cell talking with the other one. The grid cell is isolated on the plot, but it's actually part of the grid, and that's how we handle the circulation. There are different family of models, which we call box models, but I did not really discuss that today. And for the ease of use of the models, so I said, I didn't know it was possible, but I had a colleague last week who's been running Chimera on a laptop. It was just a one-day simulation, I think. I don't know. I think the ease of use is also very dependent on the user and the availability of the training, because nothing is obvious, but good training helps a lot. And then tomorrow, I will present also a few examples of surrogate models, who can be quite interesting also if you are interested in not using the full model, but you want to have an approximation that is derived with this model. So I will explain you how we can build a simplified model that can maybe give you the answer you need. So this surrogate model are also a good candidate.
Okay, thank you very much, Augustin. So if you have more questions, Augustin is here until tomorrow. He will have another presentation with case studies. Huh? So we'll be back at 2:30, precisely. Okay, thanks.